All right, everybody, we figured we'd get this thing rolling, and as everybody finishes their obligations, they'll start coming in. The gate tonight was $2.2 million, actually almost $2.3 million. Attendance was $15,545. The bonuses were $65,000. Submission of the night goes to Travis Browne. Knockout of the night goes to Ben Rothwell. And the fight of the night was Yagan versus Hominick. Congratulations, everybody. And it was tough. It was a tough decision over. He was hurt and came back, and, you know, but we'll take care of you too, kid. All right?
Cool.
Great night of fights. I seriously couldn't be happier. I love it when these guys, I always say it all the time. As what we do at the UFC is we put on all the bells and whistles, and these guys always come out and deliver, and they delivered tonight big time. It was an awesome show, and I couldn't be happier. Who's got the first question?
Dana, to your left.
Hey, Kev.
I was wondering if you can give me your thought on John's performance, and did you think he elevated himself tonight with the way he fought under a pressure situation against Rashad?
Great question. You know, one of the things about these fights, these grudge matches, you know, it usually means that these guys really respect each other. You saw respect in there tonight. The thing that I thought was great for Jon Jones is, you know, first five-rounder against a tough guy. I thought he fought a great fight. He was throwing elbows like they were hands. I thought he fought a great fight tonight. I thought Rashad did too, though. You know, Rashad, you and I spoke about this, and I've talked about it a lot leading up to this fight. I think that Rashad Evans is a guy who hasn't got the respect that he deserves. Guy's been in the UFC since 2005, won the Ultimate Fighter at heavyweight, and has only been beat now by Jon Jones and Machida.
And when you look at it, considering what John's done, the run he had last year, beating a top 10 guy, does this close the gap in your mind on Anderson?
Yeah, well, you know, it's always funny. You know, I don't know if those of you that have been looking on Twitter, now the big thing is everybody says Dan Henderson will definitely beat Jon Jones. So I like that. Not a bad thing. So everybody's ready for the next one. You know, I think Jon Jones is going to be one of these kids. He's 24 years old. He's so young. You know, in every fight that he gets, he's gaining experience as he goes, and there's no doubt about it. I mean, Dan Henderson will definitely be a big test for John too.
But to go back to that, do you think that what you've seen, you know, beating Shogun, Rampage,
Machida, it's unbelievable,
and then tonight, do you think that that puts him closer to Anderson, and does it make a contest who's number one in your mind?
You know, it's the thing you got to understand is my Anderson Silva thing is Anderson Silva has been in the UFC for a long time, has never been beat, has literally cleaned out an entire division. And the only guy who's even come close to beating him, Chael Sonnen, he is going to rematch here pretty soon. So it's tough to put anybody in that number one spot as long as Anderson Silva is still undefeated. In my opinion, what the hell do I know?
For Travis, please. Travis, obviously, very emotional, finish there for you. Can you talk about maybe what was going through your mind, what this win means for you, why it was such an emotional moment for you?
Yeah, I mean, I moved to Albuquerque for my camps. This was the first eight-week camp that I did in Albuquerque, and it was tough, man. I mean, I didn't really get a chance to go back and forth like I had wanted to see my kids, so I really didn't get. I only got to see them once in 8 weeks, and those of you that know me know that I put them first before anything else. And that win was for them, definitely. I mean, they sacrificed more than I do. You know, just not being around their dad every single day. So it meant a lot, man. It really did.
And with a six-fight main card tonight, I saw a lot of fans wondering why you weren't on the main card, you know, with what you've done so far in the UFC. Did you feel any disrespect at all that you were kind of stuck on the prelims this evening?
Troublemaker.
Yeah, right. No, not at all. Joe Silva, Dana White, they do things for a reason. And, they have a way of pulling the best out of me. And I think, they're just doing what they have to do to get the best out of Travis Browne.
And one final question, Travis. It looks like somehow, somewhere, there's going to be one slot open somewhere on this May card coming up for a heavyweight. Would you be ready?
I'm ready.
Over here, Dana. Yeah. Angel Cordero from the MMA Truth in Puerto Rico. First of all, congratulations on this event. A lot of people seem to have been underestimating a lot the undercard to this event. What do you think as a fan of the fights tonight?
I agree, brother. I think that the main event was so big, it just overshadowed the entire card. This was a great card. We knew it was a great card. And you know, the co-main event, I expected the co-main event to be a dogfight and an absolute war. Rory proved the night he's the real deal. The undercard was great. Let me tell you what, I've been traveling a lot. I've been everywhere. I've been doing all this stuff. I was so excited tonight by, like, the fourth fight into the pay-per-view. It was a great night. And contrary to what he thinks, you know, it doesn't matter. We put six guys on the card, and people are chirping. This guy, that guy wasn't on the main card. But, you know, we did. We tried to pack this thing. When we started this event tonight, we were 30 minutes over the pay-per-view window. So these guys delivered, and we were able to stuff a lot more fights onto the pay-per-view card, which we like to do. It's a little scary, but we did it.
Was that the reason why the walkouts didn't make it?
Yeah, well, okay. Yeah, we got real scared after the Bocek fight.
Wow.
After that Bocek fight went the distance, we were 30 minutes over the pay-per-view window, where if the main event went five rounds, you'd have got cut off around, you know, the third round.
Okay, the UFC has been taking a special interest lately in Puerto Rico, with Rashad visiting, Primetime visiting, and VJ is in Puerto Rico right now promoting UFC 145. When can we expect another event in Puerto Rico?
Yeah, as we continue to travel around the world and go into all these different markets, Puerto Rico is a strong market for fighting, and we're very focused on it right now. We did this thing now. We're opening up in the bars where people can watch it in the bars, and we're getting that market kickstarted.
Okay, in behalf of all the MMA fans in Puerto Rico, I brought you a pound of Puerto Rican coffee and a T-shirt that says Dana White, bring UFC back to Puerto Rico.
Well, thank you very much, sir. I appreciate it. I don't drink coffee, but I appreciate it. you can give it to him right here, the big guy texting all his friends over here.
Talking about that Puerto Rico situation, do you have maybe a little kind of time frame? Maybe you can have a UFC event in Puerto Rico?
Oh, I have no idea. Yeah, but we're just starting. What we're doing is, like I said, we're getting it out there. We're putting it in all the bars and getting people interested. I saw when Rashad went there, the people there are already interested in the UFC. But yeah, we're working on it.
How important is for you guys getting a little more into Latin America?
It's very important, but you know, our push into Brazil, you know, proved what I always thought. I thought Mexico would take off a lot quicker than it has. You know, it's tough to get in there and secure the television deal that we want, but Brazil has proven what I always thought about South America. So we're starting at Brazil, and we're working our way up this way. Thank you.
Dan, if you just give your thoughts on Rory McDonald's performance in the co-main event, and another part to that question, Mark Hominick, are you surprised that he's fallen three fights in a row like that?
I think Rory looked awesome tonight, man. I think he's the real. I thought that fight was going to be a war. He went in there and made quick work of him. At the end of the first round, it looked like Che had been in a five-round fight. At the end of that first round, Rory is nasty. And then, Hominick. You know, I love Mark Hominick. He's a great guy and everything else. But I had that fight scored 2-1. I thought that Hominick won the last round and Yagan had won the first two rounds. And it's just one of those things. I think that Yagan was tired. He was hurt. And he should have went after him more. He should have stayed on him and tried to finish that fight in the third round, because in my opinion, he had already lost the first two. You know, but you get some of these corner men that are telling him, yeah, you're in this fight. And even the judges had that fight a split decision. I didn't have it a split decision. But again, what do I know? Not a judge. Hope I answered your question.
Hey, Dana. Ron Kruk, Inside MMA. We've seen some heated rivalries in the UFC light heavyweight division. You know, going back to the Couture's versus Liddell's, where does Evans and Jones rank with some of those great rivalries?
Yeah, I mean, this was a big one. I guess I'll tell you on Monday. We'll see how the pay-per-view did, but I think it was a big fight. There was a lot of buzz and a lot of energy about this fight, and I think, like I was saying to Kevin earlier, I think it was a really good fight for Jon Jones. It was good for Jon Jones to go five rounds. It was good for Jon Jones to have a guy that made him think and not just go in and double leg a guy and drop elbows on him. You know, I thought Jon Jones fought a great fight tonight. You know how the critics are, and the haters are going to talk a bunch of smack about how Jon didn't do this and Jon didn't do that. Well, what you got to do is you got to respect Rashad Evans. Give Rashad Evans the respect he deserves, and you can give Jon Jones the respect he deserves tonight.
You mentioned Dan Henderson.
Speak of the devil.
What's up, bro? Is that confirmed that Jon's next opponent will be Dan Henderson?
Yeah, we told Dan Henderson that he would fight the winner of this fight.
This question's for Ben. You mentioned that you did a lot of things differently moving in this fight in terms of conditioning and whatnot. I wanted you to elaborate on that.
Thanks, bro. I started a gym in Kenosha, Wisconsin, my hometown, with Thiago Vega and Luis Claudio. They're now my head time coaches. I've totally changed my camp. And they took over my training. I did everything they told me to do. I think a lot of people notice a difference in how I look and everything that's been going on, and it's because of them. I hand everything over to them. I have a lot of great people with me in my hometown that got behind me and helped me train for this fight, and it's something I never had before. So between the support that I've gotten from my fans and the support from my hometown and the new coaches, all these changes are what made me.
Did you feel like you needed a win in this fight more than ever?
Yeah, it was all or nothing. I said that in a few times before the fight, that my first three performances in the UFC, even with one of them being a win, were all very disappointing to me. I know that I had so much more to show. I'm just very thankful that Dana White and Joe Silva have been patient with me, and tonight they got to see why they brought me into the UFC, and you know, tonight was my night.
Yeah, and for Rashad, do you feel like 185 is a possibility at all, or do you still feel like you'd be up there and can work your way back up to a rematch?
No, I'm a 205 pounder. You know, I've only lost twice, and you know, I lost some good competitors. So, I mean, you know, it'd be nice if I won all my fights, but it don't happen like that sometimes. But if an opportunity happens at 185, then I'll take it. But I like 205. I feel like I can work my way back up and get back to another title shot.
First question is for Michael McDonald. Michael, we know Miguel Torres, former champion, obviously very big name in the division. What kind of statement do you think you made tonight, by not only winning, but to knock him out in the first round that way?
Well, I hope, you know, on the public standpoint, that it, you know, kind of confirmed that I'm not just a kid who, you know, hadn't fought anyone good. And I hope that really solidifies people, me and people's minds, that, you know, I'm here and I'm here to stay and I hit hard.
And for Dana, what did you think of the knockout with Michael? And I know it's the in-the-mix question, but, you know, we got the big bantamweight title fight coming up in July. I mean, where does he fit, do you feel? I mean, did he make that kind of statement for you that he could be in the title race?
I don't know if you saw what I tweeted. I tweeted that was a huge win for him. Huge win. He looked great doing it, and I don't know. We'll see.
And a question for Rashad. Obviously, tough loss tonight, but just, you know, thinking back about the fight, how would you grade your performance?
You know, I don't think I did a good job. I didn't do the things that, you know, I trained to do. And it was just something I wish I had back. You know, a couple moments in a fight that I feel like I could have took advantage of some situations. But I didn't do it. And it was my mental block. And I didn't go out there and perform the way I wanted to.
And now that John's here, for John, of course, congratulations on the win. Obviously, such a huge rivalry, so much emotion in this fight. Can you just talk to us about how that felt in the fight? Did it affect you at all? It seemed like you were very cool, calm, and collected, but obviously, I know you were, you know, critical of your own performance. You didn't finish, but how did you kind of feel all the way through the fight?
I felt great, man. You know, Rashad, he's an awesome opponent. He's definitely game. He's fast. He has swag. He punches hard. And, you know, I just felt as if the fight elevated me to a different level. You know, I definitely respected Rashad a lot. And, you know, I think I was a little intimidated at some points to just believe in my ability and speed and coordination. I think as a result, I didn't fight as clean as I would like to have. But it was a great fight, and I respect Rashad a lot and thank him for taking this fight.
Well, thank you.
You're welcome.
Question for John. John, were you right over to your right here? What's up?
Shrekka.
How are you? Oh, were you at all hurt? I mean, he clipped you a few times during the fight. Did you feel his power? And we, you know.
Yeah, definitely. I wouldn't say that I was hurt, but he definitely wobbled me. Getting wobbled doesn't actually hurt. My leg kicks hurt, and he actually has my leg sore. I'm surprised because he's not much of a kicker, and he kicked very well tonight. So I wasn't hurt, but he did wobble me. There's one point where I had gotten hit, and I was like, oh, okay, I felt that. And then, you know, I tried to side shuffle, and I realized I stumbled, which means I must have been rocked. He rocked me, and I was happy that I was able to take punches from Rashad because he's a very powerful puncher.
What did you learn about yourself tonight?
You know, I learned that I need to just trust my stuff a little bit more and not be intimidated, you know, by people, what they have, and just to trust what I have. You know, like I said before, I definitely move very fluently when I'm going against a heavy bag or a coach with mitts And tonight, I kind of felt gangly and uncoordinated at some points. I know that came from slight insecurity in my attacks.
And Dana, last question. Can you talk about Matt Browne versus Wonder Boy? I thought that was a great fight. And did you maybe think that could have been fight of the night as well?
Yeah, no doubt about it. That fight was awesome. You know, it was one of those wars where one guy's rocked, then the other guy's rocked, and they both kept going after it. And it was a huge win for Matt Browne tonight, who is a warrior. I always love when he fights. He's always exciting, and I'm very happy for him. Yeah, you know, it was only kid's second fight in the UFC, and you know, you look at records, and if you look at a guy like Matt Browne, you know, Silva's good at matching guys up. Tonight was a test for Wonder Boy, and Matt Browne, you know, he's a gritty, tough guy that's always in wars, and a true veteran of not only the sport but the UFC. Those are tough guys to fight.
Cyrus Fees, MMA Inside the Cage. This is for Dana. Ben Rothwell had a very exciting performance, very dominant performance there with the knockout. What sort of chances does he have to fill that spot on the May card where there is the opening right now due to Overeem being off and Mir taking the main event spot?
Yeah, we had a few guys here tonight that finished fights quick and took no damage. But what I really respect about Rothwell is he's a guy, you know, who, you know, had a little adversity coming into the UFC, went in, got in great shape. We were watching the weigh-ins at the office when he weighed in, and I was like, damn, he looks good. He's never looked that good. You know, I respect that. The guy went out, he got in good shape, and came out with a big win tonight, and I'm happy for him. And yes, the guys who come out, listen, we need guys to fight. You know, we're doing a lot of shows and everything else, and any guy that comes off with a quick win, we'd love to turn them right back around. So, but again, the thing you guys got to understand, there's situations like when they asked him about, you know, you ready to get back in there? The guy just said, I haven't seen my kids in 6 weeks. I miss my kids. You know, last thing you want to do is call a guy back. I know how hard training camp is, and like he said, how much they sacrifice. So it's not easy to turn a guy around that quick.
Dana, a little off topic. You wear black on black better than anyone.
Thank you. You know. I appreciate that, buddy. Isn't he the best?
One more question. This one's for John. John, in the fight, of course, we kind of saw the taunt from Rashad. Were you expecting to maybe see the customary Rashad Evans taunt at some point in the fight? Did it affect you whatsoever? Did it get you going a little bit more when you got that little taunt? I think it was the second round.
It didn't get me going a little bit more, but I was just like, man, this guy is just so smooth. Like, look at him. And the people, I thought I was winning that round, but he still got cheers. I was like, hey, don't cheer. I'm winning this round. You know, what are you doing? But he's just a smooth operator, man. It was I didn't expect it. And, you know, I just wanted to land even more. You know, I was like, oh, don't do that in here with me, you know. But
what was going on in the final round when you kind of went to the shuffle mode there for 10 to 15 seconds? You were kind of running a little shuffle around him. What was going on in your head with that?
You know, just to be free, just to be free. And, you know, it is a game. And I felt as if he was respecting it and not attacking when I was doing that. So I was like, sweet, if you're going to let me shuffle around, I'm going to get my air back, you know. So that's what that kind of was about.
Casey Oxendale with MMA Inside the Cage. This is for John. Also, you know, there's a lot of talk going into this fight about the camp, of course, with Greg Jackson. And, you know, do you still affirm right now that the Jackson camp, your preparation that way, had a big part in this fight?
Yeah, definitely. You know, I felt right at home out there, you know, thanks to my coaches and my teammates. You know, I didn't hire anybody new for this camp, the exact same team that I had before, and teammates. Brought in only one wrestler to help me out, and he volunteered because you know, he wrestles with my wrestling coach Izzy. But anyways, yeah, I believe in my team wholeheartedly, and my whole team sacrificed their fighting styles to mimic Rashad at the best of their ability. My wrestling coach Izzy style wrestling, he had me really comfortable in the clinch and positions that we knew would be in. Mike Wingo-John, my kickboxing coach, had, you know, me do tons of reps that things we felt would land, and Greg Jackson with strategy and just really teaching me how to be the warrior that I am today. So I believe in my team wholeheartedly, and you know, I definitely kind of felt like I was fighting for the honor of the program, and it meant a lot to me to you know, defend our team's honor.
Nice. Well, Dana's already confirmed that it's going to be Dan Henderson that you're going to meet. That's another legend. Any thoughts on that already? You know, has that already crossed your mind? And
you know what? You know, I feel great that I already have a mission, and I'm going to work extremely hard to better myself. I did things that I could have done better. And Dan Henderson is an awesome opponent. He's a winner. He has a huge fan base. I'm sure the haters gonna come right away, which I'm okay with. So it's just gonna be a lot of things to conquer in this fight. You know, he has extreme knockout power. I don't know who hits harder between him and Rampage, but he has extreme knockout power, and I'm excited to conquer.
Hey, Dana, in 2008 when the UFC came, you joked that you guys weren't able to beat Barbara Streisand here at the Phillips Arena. Any idea if you guys beat her tonight, and is there a sooner return? Do you think we might expect a sooner return for the UFC?
I forgot this was the Barbara Streisand Arena. if we did, they would have told me. So Barbara beat us again, apparently.
do you think we might see you guys sooner instead of a 2.5 year return next time?
Listen, this is a great market, and obviously this fight proved that this market is really growing here for us, so we'll see what happens. But that's the question I get every time we leave a place: when are you coming back? Right. We'll see.
Right. And then for John, right here, you had a submission and knockouts in your previous title defenses. Do you think this was a tougher title defense for you?
I would totally say that Rashad has been my toughest fight to date, and I think a lot of it was because of how talented and awesome of a fighter he is, and a lot of it came from slight insecurity fighting Rashad. You know, Rashad, he did big brother me a few times when we used to work out together, so having that in the back of my head, it made me more hesitant, and so I really had to fight myself in this fight as well as fighting Rashad Evans. So mentally, I think I've been brought to a different level for sure.
Victoria Blahova, Russian Chicago Magazine. Dana, you tweeted earlier that you felt so excited you almost died. Is everything okay?
I'm sorry, ma'am. What did you say?
You tweeted earlier that you got
excited
at the beginning of the night that you almost died.
I'm fine. I've been running hard, and I'm all right. I'm going to live today anyway.
Where are you from?
Russia.
Oh, very nice.
And now question to Rashad and to you, John.
Well, I didn't know.
It's actually Belarus.
Wait, say it again.
Belarus.
Belarus. Oh, nice.
Guys, what have you learned through the last year, according to friendship, sportsmanship, behavior? What lessons have you gotten from that experience?
What lessons have you learned from this situation?
Over the past year.
From the whole experience. Biggest lesson I learned from the experience is to stay away from other elite level fighters. It's always welcome new talent into the program. But just kind of stay away from elite level talent. I still got a lot of thinking to do with the whole situation. One thing I do want to get out of this is to rekindle a respect level and some type of communication with Rashad, and hopefully we can do that in private and work on that in the future. Because I do have tons of respect for Rashad, and I know he has to respect me to some degree. And there's a lot of emotion between us that could lead to a friendship. I mean, it's very easy to get along with and hang out with Rashad. So I think that's something that we both will hopefully look forward to and in our private time in the future.
Rashad?
Yeah, like John was saying, it takes a while for it to sink in, you know. I still got to go home and probably cry a little bit. But besides that, I don't know. You know, it takes some time for the lessons that you learn from a situation like this to kick in. But, like John was saying, you never know what can happen in the future. And, we were friends before, so, you never know what would happen. And, we got some cool experiences that we shared together and that we'll probably have in the future. So we'll see. We'll probably be competing again one of these days. So, we'll keep it on a level where we can say what's up, but at the same time, be willing to, beat the hell out of each other if we have to.
Oh, man.
And the last, John, the last 10 seconds of the fifth round, you glimpsed at the clock and you went for the second takedown. What was going through Amanda this time?
I went for a takedown in the last few seconds of the fight. I recall he stuffed it pretty well, shot his great hips. And then at the end of the fight, I pulled guard. And, the reason why I pulled guard is because I'm a mixed martial artist. And I think a lot of times people want to, they look at that as being like a sissy move or something, but I think a lot of Brazilian jiu-jitsu practitioners around the world loved it and really respected it. So it's part of the game, and I think it was a smart decision.
Thank you.
I got a couple questions for Rashad. Right here to your right, Rashad. Right.
I can't see that well.
Can you talk about what it was like trying to keep your confidence up during the fight? John mentioned your swagger and how he saw it in there, but is he a difficult guy to keep high on because it's just so difficult to kind of extend momentum against him?
Yeah, he was difficult. You know, he's so frustrating. He's so long, and he's very creative. So, you know, when I was just fighting from my gut, and whenever he hit me with something, I was like, man, I can't. I don't know how bad that hurt. You know. So it was a lot of pride, you know, fighting on a lot of pride. But, you know, he's a talented kid, and he's got a lot better, like I thought he did. And he was able to keep me from doing what I really wanted to do. And, you know, that's what he needed to do to get the win. So, I got to give him his respect, and you know, he's a champion.
And then I wonder if you can compare this feeling to how you felt after you lost to Lyoto Machida. And then Lyoto went on, and now people say that he's kind of been a puzzle that's been figured out. Do you think the same is for John, or do you think that after facing both of them that, you know, Lyoto had a style that people weren't really used to? Jones is just something that's special in itself that you can't really figure out.
Well, I mean, you know, Jones definitely has a talent, you know, and is different than anybody else's. So, you know, the difference I feel in this fight, you know, since I got older, I've learned how to handle setbacks a little bit better. And, you know, I know that the only thing you can do in life is just go forward. No matter how hard things get, you only can go forward and not, you know, hang your head lower, because things can always be worse, you know. And even when you think you're at rock bottom, you can go lower. So I take that and say, I lost tonight, but tomorrow I'll win, I'll get better. And I'll continue to be try to be champion.
Rashad, question right here.
Right here.
How did you feel tonight about your performance? Did you feel like did you get outclassed? Where were you tonight?
I got out slicked. You know, I got out slicked. You know, I thought I was gonna be able to get him because I felt his timing was off. And his timing is really never off. So I felt like he was nervous, you know, because when he first came out, he was a little bit looser than he normally is. Normally he's a little tighter. So I was like, okay, he's a little bit nervous. And then he started playing a hand game. So I was thinking, okay, this is where I'm going to be able to take him down because he's going to touch. And I know he's going to go for the elbow. And then that's when I'm going to drop. But every single time he went for the elbow, I wasn't really ready for it. And he caught me with it. So he all slicked me on that.
What was the game plan going into tonight's fight?
It was just a fight, you know. It was a fight. I knew where John's tough at, and I knew where he's hard at. You know, to try to take him down in the open mat is pretty hard to do. You know, so I was just going to try to see, you know, if I got a shot, I was going to take it. But if not, I wasn't going to force anything. And but at the same time, I need to be creative, and I wasn't creative enough. You know, I threw an inside leg kick, and he checked it with his knee. And I couldn't really bounce after that. I lost the springs in my shoes. So, but you know, he fought a good fight.
Fighting infrequently as of late, do you think that had an impact on your performance tonight?
No, I just think that I was flat. I was flat when I came out. You know, I didn't really feel like my normal self. And I had a great camp, but just sometimes you go out and you don't feel it. You know. There was times in the fight where I was like, okay, I felt like I could have done something, and I just didn't do it. I didn't pull the trigger when I needed to. And, you know, those are just the frustrating things where I gotta go back and just figure out what I did wrong.
And one last question for Rory. Rory, could you just tell me a little bit about how you feel about your performance tonight?
Yeah, I'm happy with the victory, but I made some mistakes. I need to look at the tape and you know, fix them in the gym. But, you know, I'm happy I won. But, again, need to make some improvements on some things.
Jose Santiago with Inside Punch. Dana, quick question for you about Miguel Torres. You guys brought him back, and this is, I think he has 45 fights now. This is a third loss recently where he's looked really bad, not just getting knocked out, but, you know, laid out for a little while. What are your thoughts about Miguel Torres? Any concern there?
Yeah, I mean, he got caught tonight. I mean, he got caught with a big punch. This kid was on him. He looked good. He looked fast. But Miguel came out fighting his game tonight. He was sticking that jab, you know, moving around. And kid went in and the hell he went. But the kid that used to be sitting over there went in and and handled his business, man. He looked good tonight. You know, I don't know. We'll see about Miguel, though. But make no mistakes, I like Miguel, and, you know, he's a great guy. And, you know, that whole thing that happened through Twitter, he was a man and handled his business, and we're all good, so.
Dana, this question is for you, Marcus from MMA Net. And the question is regarding Overeem. You guys decided to pull him, even though his test is on, or hearing is on Wednesday. Why did you decide to pull him before the testing?
Well, you know, we were right up on deadlines with a lot of things that we need to do to promote a pay-per-view. And I'm not very optimistic on Tuesday, so.
Also, with Brazil, have you guys gone any further with that? Do you know what's happening with it?
Me and Chael Sonnen are on our way to Brazil tonight.
Thank you.
Yep.
Last questions for Rory. Right here, Rory. Is there anyone specific that you want after this fight now? Are you going to lobby for a top 10 opponent, perhaps?
I'm not calling anyone out. Just want more fights. I want to be more active. You know, it seems like the pattern has been like one fight a year, maybe two, and I haven't been enjoying that. So I'm going to make some changes and stay a little bit more healthy and fight more regularly.
Hey, Dana, this question is for you. I'm with Josh Lee. I'm with Monster Gym, a website in Korea. We're one of the few sites that covered, you know, UFC and MMA in the country. And with the growing popularity of, you know, UFC and MMA in Asia, in Korea, Japan, Tokyo, what are your kind of your plans for expanding the sport into, you know, different continents?
Yeah, I've been talking about Korea for about a year and a half now about going in there. We're working on Korea, getting an event over there. We're working on China, and we've made a lot of progress in China. China's a tough place to get into and do business. Right. We're actually, off the top of my head, I can't remember the date, but we have a date planned already for China. And India, we got the Ultimate Fighter going. I know that's not Asia, but it's out there.
It's Asia.
It is? Well, it there is. You go. Shows you what I know.
I mean, what are your plans for Korea? Because, I mean, there's a number of UFC fighters, you know, like the Korean Zombie, Ben Henderson, he's half Korean. I mean, there's a lot of, you know, UFC fighters that are coming out of Korea at this moment. And the sport is, you know, growing exponentially, you know, within the country. So I just kind of want to know your thoughts on, you know, your future, your plans for Korea as a country.
What's my plan?
I mean, do you have one? Or?
Yeah. That's what I was just saying. We've had a plan for like a year and a half to get in there. It's just a matter of getting it done now. Yeah, sure. Korea is very important to us. Sure. Korea is just as important as China. And, you know, we kicked off that fight in Japan. The Japan fight was very successful. Sure. We got things rolling in China. India, faster than we thought we would. And Korea's next, too.
Okay.
We do have a plan. We plan on going there, and we're working on it.
Okay. We're looking forward to it. And, John, congratulations on the fight, on your victory.
Thanks, brother.
And Michael Stetz, MMA Diehards. Question for Dana. Dana, over here.
Yeah.
Now that John successfully defended the light heavyweight belt, you know, several times now, first since Chuck Liddell, is that something you prefer as the, you know, head of UFC, having, instead of having the belt always change hands? Do you feel better when you have champions keep defending their belts?
It is what it is. I mean, if it's in a situation in a weight division where it keeps changing hands, you know, it is what it is. If we get a guy who dominates for years, like an Anderson Silva or a George St. Pierre, you know, there's nothing that I ever hope for. Or I'm like, hope this happens, hope that. It is what it is. This thing just unfolds, however it plays out.
And a question for John. Congratulations, of course, on the win. And your goals for 2012. You said you wanted to finish every fight. You won five rounds. I'm sure. Maybe something you haven't done before. Maybe you could take a positive spin on it. But if you're going to fight Dan Henderson, I'm sure you know you want to finish him. But how would you see that going? I mean, that's a pretty tall order to finish Henderson. You might see another five rounder.
Right. You know, I'm just a big believer in goal setting. I think it's very important. I think if you don't have goals, you're easy to sway to the left or the right. And having goals really just keeps you on a path, and it keeps you
with your eyes set on something. So, you know, you can train to hope that you win, or you can train to finish and to do something amazing. And I think, you know, I just think it's important. And I think when you fall short from an excellent goal, you land in still on the good side. So I didn't finish a shot, but I still feel good about the performance. And, you know, my goal will be to finish Dan Henderson, with all due respect.
John, William McCray, Post News Group. Wanted to know how important would it have been for a knockout tonight? It seemed like the crowd was really kind of looking forward to that, and it seemed like when they started booing, you kind of responded and tried to make that happen.
Yeah, it was important. It was important to me. I wanted to back up what I was saying and be a man of my word, and you know, I told Rashad that I really wanted him to be my first career knockout, and I really wanted to, you know, prove to myself that I can do what I set my mind to, but I didn't. But I still sit here extremely grateful that I'm not injured, and that neither of us are injured, and that we, you know, live to fight another day.
Rashad, it seemed like I think it was in the second round, kind of got you. You did a little, kind of like a little dance move that kind of played it off, and it seemed like it kind of went downhill from there. Could you speak to that for
him? I really don't remember what round it went downhill. when you go that many rounds, all the rounds just seem to blur together. I forget what happened, but he was just able to just find his timing, find his range, and just, you know, just catch me at my weaknesses. So I mean, I don't know what's trying to happen, but you know, he was able to do what he needed to do.
This question here is for Rory, right here. Jeff Armstrong, Griffin Daily News. Wanted to ask you, you've already faced Carlos Condit. He's the interim champion and all that. Would you welcome a rematch down the line? I mean, if he can't fight George St. Pierre anytime soon, do you think you're ready for it, or do you want to just, like you said, get more fights and try to work your way up to that, maybe next year or something like that?
Yeah, I'd take a rematch with Carlos any moment I could. I know he's in line to fight George, so, you know, hopefully George will beat him and I'll get my shot, but I'm looking forward to that rematch.
Okay. Rashad, I have a question.
Sorry, I have to leave early, guys.
All right. Rashad, over here, I had a question for you. Mm-hmm. When you were critiquing John's fight against Rampage, you were saying how Rampage didn't get into his chest. And I was wondering, did you think about trying to get into his chest when you were fighting, or was you just, your mental block stopped you or something like that?
Yeah, I wanted to put more pressure on him, but at the same time, I didn't want to rush it, you know, because he does have those long knees.
Right.
So I didn't want to rush it, and I know he was expecting me to do that. So I try to really attack people where they're least expecting me. I just didn't throw enough combinations in them the right way I needed to, and that was the story of the night for me. Right. Not throwing enough, not getting off enough, not being first enough, and it cost me the fight. You know, there was opportunities where I had him landed a good shot or so, but I didn't follow up with the meaningful combinations, and it cost me the fight. So I really got no one to blame but myself, and I know what I need to do to get the job done. I just didn't get it done tonight.
Right. And one more question. This one's for Ben. You were very emotional after your fight. You were thanking the fans and all that. I mean, how much did this win mean for you? You might have said earlier, but I mean, how much did it go, and how much did the fan support really carried you tonight? It's
the biggest win of my career right now. I mean, I've done some things, but this is my biggest win. It's in the UFC. It was a knockout, and as you can tell, I worked very hard for this. So of course, it's a big night for me. Thank you.
I'm going to take one more question.
Rashad, to your left. First of all, I was wondering, was the distance a problem? Like, you seem like you could never get it the correct distance.
Yeah, you know, I started playing a game, and I knew better to play it. What threw me off with doing it, what I was planning to do, is because the front kick, you know, I knew he was going to try to come up. I originally planned to go to the body, start with the body, and start building up, but I was never able to do that, and I wasn't consistent enough with my pressure, with my punches. So I just didn't, you know, do what I felt like I needed to do.
And I wanted to ask you, you know, Anderson's been unbeaten in the UFC and had all the records. When you look at John in the last year beating Hua, Rampage, Machida, now tonight, you know, a convincing win over you, do you think he's closed the gap or in any way past Anderson?
Well, I mean, you know, talking about Anderson Silva, he's done quite a bit in the sport, you know. I think John's definitely on his way. You know, he definitely deserves his credit, but he's still yet to clean out everybody in the weight class. So Anderson, they can't find really nobody to go with him except for Chael. So, you know, it remains to be seen if he'll get to that level, but it looks like he's on his way there.
And I guess the last question for you, what is the path that you go on? You said you want to get back and get, you know, to the title shot. I mean, there doesn't seem to be anybody that's natural for you out there. Anybody you're looking at?
Nah, you know, I'm a fighter, man, and that's what I do. So whoever the UFC puts in front of me, I'll continue to fight, and I'll put wins together like I always do, and we'll see where that leads me.
Thank you guys so much for your support. We appreciate you. Have a good night.
Last week you were like, I'm so mad, I don't want to talk about it. Please don't let me talk about it. Where was your anger directed?
I'm still angry.
At Alistair or the commission? Where's that anger directed?
No, I'm not angry with the commission. The commission's doing their job. That's what they do. I sat down in a room with Alistair, told me they can test me anytime they want. I'm the most tested athlete in all of sports.
Think you can still do business with him at this point, or do you wait till Tuesday to make that decision?
I do business with Tito. I think I can do business with Alistair.
So he's not in danger of actually being cut or anything?
We'll see what happens. I don't know, man. This isn't really my deal.
Have you talked to Overeem since then personally?
I have not. And I will not.
If Nevada doesn't license him, you would allow him to apply for a license in another state?
To apply in another state?
Yeah.
No way. No way in hell. If Nevada doesn't license him get licensed somewhere else? No way. I don't think another state would do it either.
What about overseas?
No, we would never do that. When an athletic commission, whether it's Nevada, New Jersey, or whoever it is, you know, suspends somebody or does whatever, will deny them a license, we follow. We don't.
So we
ran toward regulation. We want to be regulated.
So if he applies, it's turned down, it's a year, you're not using him for the year. Is that what you're saying?
Right.
Why was Mir the guy? Why was that the choice?
You know, in my opinion, it was either Mir or Verdum. You know, Verdum's going to fight down in Brazil on the Brazil card, I believe. But, you know, Mir was already training. Mir was already on the card. And Mir makes a lot of sense. Mir would probably be my number one, and Verdum would be my number two.
What about the reports that you said that Anderson would be fired if he didn't fight?
That is bullshit.
It's complete. I never.
That is such a fucking lie.
It got around yesterday.
It's crazy. I tweeted yesterday. Yeah. Wherever that came from, if it was a media source or whoever said it, it's an absolute flat-out lie. Just like I bet $500,000 on Jon Jones. You know, there's a lot of stupid shit that goes on in this sport now with people. You know, you get these fucking goofy websites that want to get some hits and you know. It makes me sick. Makes me sick. Never once did I say that. And never have Anderson and I haven't had a problem about this fight. You know, there's reports out of Brazil with Anderson saying, I want to fight in Brazil. Of course he does. Of course he wants to fight Chael Sonnen in Brazil. I get it. You know, and Chael Sonnen is 100% willing to go to Brazil and fight him. There's been no beef whatsoever with me and Anderson Silva. And I never said anything like that. Anderson Silva is a guy, I just sat here 2 minutes ago saying, you know, yeah, John looks great, but John's too young. Anderson Silva's the pound-for-pound best fighter in the world, probably the best ever. But I'm going to strip him of that title if he doesn't fight. I never said anything like that. Stupid.
Is there a potential that fight doesn't happen in Brazil now, though?
Yeah, there's stuff going on down in Brazil, and I'm working on it. We're working on it still at this minute.
What's the kind of deadline? Because you're getting close.
I know, man. Stadium. It's always fun, isn't it? There's always just so much fun shit going on for me.
Who's fighting Velasquez?
Velasquez, yeah. Sorry, you guys are way in the back. We haven't got the fight done yet. We're still working on that one. I'll talk louder here. No. To fight Velasquez? No. Mark Hunt's fighting Struve. That fight's still on. Mark Hunt's fighting Struve. He beat Struve. His next fight will be a top five opponent.
That was
I know. I get the whole appeal of Mark Hunt. I love what Mark Hunt has done too, but he doesn't deserve the shot over Verdum, over Mir. You know, he just doesn't.
What would happen to that Brazil card if Anderson Chill somehow does get moved?
Nothing. I mean, we'll still do a card down in Brazil, too. The time would just be moved. The problem is, you guys know what the problem is down there, right?
Yeah. Well, the UN.
The United Nations is having a conference down there. There isn't enough hotel rooms. There's not enough security down there. There's not enough a lot of things.
But why does that force the move of Anderson and Chael? Why? Because there's a potential that fight happens July 7th, correct?
Yeah, no. That fight needs to be done in a way that, first of all, we're going to do it in a soccer stadium down there. You know, that's what we were working on. I said it before and I'll say it again. That's not only the biggest fight in the UFC, I think it's one of the biggest sporting events of the year. So that fight's going to be done the right way. We're not going to half-ass that thing and say, oh, let's go over to this arena over here. It's going to be a big fight.
Could you not go into HSBC like you've done before?
Yeah, but no. It won't work down there. We need a... it just won't work. That fight won't work down there. For a lot of different reasons.
Is so, that a done thing, or is there still a little potential that it may
we'll
happen?
I have no clue.
Can you go a week earlier? I mean, is there a stadium available?
No, we tried to move this thing all around. That's what we tried to figure out. And this is a big fight. This isn't just this is one of our regular, let's just move this thing over here, let's do this. It's a big fight. It needs to be done the right way.
Does that mean like we're talking about moving it a couple months down the line and still the same card? Or?
Pavilion Vitor was happening.
No. No.
That conference has been planned for a while, though. How come it just became an issue?
It was never an issue. It became an issue when the people that were running the conference went to the mayor and said, can't do this. They came to us, and the mayor was fighting for it and trying to keep it. And, you know, the whole thing just fell apart. Dude, I told you guys at one of the press conferences, we went after that U2 staging that U2 used for their concert. You know, we've had guys fly down there 5-6 times doing site surveys. We had the whole arena mapped out and ready to go. You know, we were pumped and ready for that. And you know, if it's not a stadium show, then it's not happening down there. So
Vitor and Vanderlei would be a main event.
It will move Vitor and Vanderlei, and yeah, we'd rebuild the card and do something else.
What about the tweet from Lorenzo over to Eddie Alvarez following his big win? Is there anything behind that? Would you like to have Eddie Alvarez into your division? Is there any substance?
Eddie Alvarez is a great fighter. You know us, man. We're always looking to get the best fighters in the world in the UFC. And he's one of them.
Did you see his fight with Alki?
What's that?
Did you see his fight with Alki?
No. I was filming The Ultimate Fighter when it happened, but I heard...
Any update on
Victor
Lumber?
I like him. I like him. I like him a lot.
I think he revealed that there's a contract offer. Is there any update on what the status that is?
We'll see what happens. You know, we'll see what happens.
Michael McDonald looked great. Brad Pickett looked great recently. Seems like that matchup would make a lot of sense.
That's a fun fight. Yeah, I love Brad Pickett, man. I love the way that kid fights. And like I said tonight, Rory's a real deal. I really, when Rogue and I were going live on a pay-per-view, we were so pumped about that fight. We were talking about Jay Mills kicks and hits like a beast, man. I thought that fight was going to be a war. And like I said at the press conference, at the end of the first round, Jay looked like he'd gone five. Rory's tough, man. He's a tough, tough guy.
He did seem like he needed some improvement in his stand-up. You know,
he definitely
get the fight
does.
To the ground.
He got... I have a ton of respect for Chael Mills for striking, and he lit Rory up. Rory got hit with some big shots there. But, man, the thing is if about being a mixed martial artist, if shit isn't going right on your feet, you get them down on the ground, and you do what you do down there. You know, if stuff isn't going right on the ground, you get it up to your feet, and you know, he did what he needed to do to win that fight. You're going to fight different guys with different styles, guys that are better here and there. And Rory came out tonight and proved that he could do it. You think that Chael Mills wasn't working on that takedown defense and trying to keep that thing standing? He couldn't. He couldn't keep it standing. And that's what made Rory look really good.
From the Here We Go Again files, both Rory and GSP told me on, I think it was Thursday, never going to fight each other. We'll do the division switches, all those things. Do you get angry, or how do you react to it? Because Rashad and Jones said the same thing, and then what we saw tonight. I mean, how do you react when your two guys say flat out, never going to happen?
We'll see. We'll see what happens. You know, here's what it always comes down to. And we've had this conversation a million times, guys. why are you in this? You're in this to become the world champion. You know what I mean? I guarantee you, if Rory looks at fucking GSP's bank account, he'll want to beat the shit out of him. All right? That's what it's about. It's about winning and becoming, you know, he's world, everybody around the world knows GSP. They love this guy. He makes shitloads of money, and the list goes on and on. Rory wants that, you know? And it's not like we're setting up this fight where you guys are going to fight and then you have to hate each other after. It's one of the it's the fight world. In boxing, Larry Holmes was a sparring partner for Muhammad Ali, and he had to go out and beat Ali one day, and the list goes on and on. I could go through a list of people who were sparring partners as they came up for guys and then eventually fought them. It's the world of fighting. Like I said the other day, I said this is the fight business, not the friend business. It's not. Can hang out and everybody's cool. It's one of the things that people love about this sport is the sportsmanship, the camaraderie, and everything else. But when it comes down to, you know, if I'm Rory MacDonald, I'm like, GSP's a friggin' multi-millionaire. The guy's got all kinds of accolades around the world. He's accomplished all these things and tons of great sponsors. But he's my friend. I guess I'll just sit around and never see if I can beat him. You know what I mean? It just makes no sense. When people say that, it's so stupid. It's so stupid, and it just makes no sense.
What do you think about the matchup they announced? I'm sorry, I'm going to interrupt. With the M1 Global and Fedor versus Hizo. Just out of curiosity, I'd love to get your take on that. Fedor's taking on Pedro Hizo in his next fight. What's your take on that? I know we all know your feelings towards Fedor, kind of. And what do you think about that matchup?
I don't know, man. Seriously, it just amazes me that people keep talking about Fedor. You know, it's just...
he's an intriguing guy, though. I mean, everybody still seems to love him. That's just the thing.
Yeah.
You know,
in what way is he intriguing, though? I mean, I don't get it, but... You know, Pedro Hizo, I like Pedro. He's a nice guy. I know Pedro's been looking for a fight for a while. You know, I don't know. We'll see what happens.
How do you see that one going down?
I don't know. I don't know. Who knows? I mean, you guys think that I hate Fedor. I really don't hate Fedor. You know, his management, these guys are made the biggest fuck up in the history of all sports. You know, we flew down there. You heard me talk about the island and all this shit. Flew down there and tried to make Brock Lesnar versus Fedor. And it was for big, big money, you know? And like I told you guys before, I'll say it again, they fucking laughed at it. And I told him, and he'll lie if you ask him this, but I told him, and he knows I fucking told him, not Fedor, the dummy. I told the dummy, I said, you're one punch away from being worth zero. This is a huge offer. In the fight business and in life, you get these... Things shift and things happen and build and you get an opportunity to do this mega fight, you know? And everything was in line for Fedor and Brock to fight. It was right there. And you don't laugh at those moments. You fucking seize them. You take it. He didn't take it. They thought they were too cool, too slick, and too fucking funny. And like I said before, they're not laughing now. So honestly, it's over for him. I don't give a shit what he's doing.
They didn't want to risk it.
Yeah. But at that age and at everything the way that it was, it's about, listen, I don't know how that whole deal works. They say that Fedor is a partner in that whole thing. A partner in what? Fucking M1? What the hell is that doing? Burning money. He's a partner in your burning money business? That's awesome. You're a great manager, Vidummy.